and the door will open. Seek and you will find. Ask and you'll be given the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here.
And there are times that Sim would drive his car, come here. He would come out and maybe look at the animals, sit in the chair, if I had other chairs out here which were more comfortable. Then we'd go in and just enjoy home.
Welcome to my world.
In 1967, the late Dr. Simeon Daniel returned from England as a trained lawyer. He first worked with the Robert Llewellyn Bratcher administration in St. Kitts within the legal department. Then one day, he got a call from his father, Job. He told him that there was 8 acres of land on offer at Brazier's at a cost of $20,000. The late Dr. Simeon Daniel approached Mr. Richard Dick Lupinacci of the Bank of America on St. Kitts, who, though disposed to lend him the money, thought that his meager salary of $720 could not cut it. He urged him to come to Nevis and set up his own private practice. Sim Daniel acquired the 8 acres, and we're here on location today to meet with his dear wife, Sheila, to talk about Dr. Simeon Daniel, the man.
Hi, Steve. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
How have you been?
My deepest sympathies.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're looking as well as you did. And you became Miss Nevis so many years ago.
Oh, that's a long time. Everything has changed. The color of my hair as well.
The guys are working on the...
We're working on the programs for the funeral on Tuesday.
A lot of work going into that, huh?
Yes. A lot of work. But they're getting by.
So this is where Sim spent a lot of his evenings, huh?
Yes. That's his chair.
That's his lazy boy.
Yes, that's his lazy boy.
So he would come in the evening and
And that's where he would sit. Then he would come and watch telly.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
You know, Steve, at afternoons when Sim comes up, this is where we meet, in these chairs. He comes out of his car with his cane, and in his own painful way, he would come and sit here. Sometimes I meet him here, and sometimes when I realize that he's home, I would come down the steps and we meet here. We would have our little chat, find out how his day was. He'd ask me, what did you do today? And then sit for a while, and I would say to him, let's go up. And he said, go ahead, I'm coming. I said, no, you go ahead. I said, don't fall back on me, you know, because I won't be able to hold you out. So we go up the steps. Then he would sit at a chair by the table. And that is where I would offer him a drink. Then we'd sit and have a chat. Now, when Adrian was here, Adrian would probably meet us there. And Adrian would sit on the banister, and I would sit in one chair, and Sim would be in another chair. And we have our little chit-chat, our little family chats, nothing to do with work or anybody else. And from there, we'd sit until it gets dark. And then after that, let's go in and have some dinner. He goes in, he might sit in his lazy boy chair, or if it's news time, he'd put the TV on and sit on the sofa. And he'd say, bring my dinner for me, please. Take his dinner to him. And he would say, thank you very much. This was very nice. Very complimentary he was. We would sit again and chat. And I said, you know, so I'm going into bed. I've had a busy day. And he would go into his room. And I would say, don't forget to say your prayers. And we go into our separate rooms. And that's how it is on an afternoon when he comes up. It was always a joy to know that he's coming in. and it was always a joy with the pleasantness of Sim's face. You know, very appreciative, very loving person he was. Now in the morning he come down, he goes down to Ramsbury, his little abode, and it's, if he doesn't see me, he's gonna pip his horn to let me know he's leaving the yard. If I see him, I'm off. I'm running off. I said, don't run, you might fall down the steps. I'm off. Then when he gets to the gate, he still pips his horn to let me know he has gone down.
Strong family man.
Very, very strong family man. Very strong family man. Yeah. Mm.
And he liked wines, didn't he? You said you'd sit here.
Oh, many times I would bring down a glass of wine for him or wait until he gets to the head of the steps and he'll have his wine. He loved red wine. We both loved red wine.
It's a lovely place. The national flower, huge trees, you've got palms. Did he like gardening?
He did, but he wasn't so much into flowers. But he admired my garden, you know. He admired my garden and he always said, why don't you plant banana trees or anything like that? I say, yes, I love to see my flowers blooming. And he always complimented me. He was not able at times to be walking around the garden, but he would, from the same chair, or, you know, when he gets up the steps, he'd look down and see my garden. Yes, yes. Very complimentary.
But he was more into
He was more into farming.
Into farming. Food.
Yes, and of course, he loved his animals.
Okay, we're going to see that later. Yes. What sort of crops he liked planting?
He liked banana trees, and he likes his little papaya and any little thing from that we use from a kitchen garden. Because he did have a little garden at Ramsbury by his little cottage, which he admired. And
I suppose the sort of things which didn't take a lot of his time, because
He would just sit by the door in his Ramsbury cottage and throw the seeds out, and my jiggers, they would grow.
He
had green fingers. Yes, yes.
Did he find solace in these gardens? Many great world leaders, you know, with all the difficulties that they have, being in public office, found solace among nature, did he?
In a sense, but he found solace more among his animals.
He loved animals.
He loved animals.
What sort of animals did he rear?
Well, in the earlys, he reared the sheep and the goats. Mm-hmm. But when they destroyed my garden and he saw me cry for the destruction of my crotons, he got rid of the small animals and he did the cattle farming. And that's what he loved. He loved to go by and look over on them. He loved to know, oh, you have a little heifer today, or, you know, and that sort of thing. But he always wanted his animals around him, and I always catered to that.
What do you think animals meant to him?
I think as a youngster growing up in Barnscott from his dad, the animals were part of his upbringing. You know, they had to get up in the morning and look after the animals, tend to the animals, and that sort of thing. And it was from there. It came from his upbringing at, you know,
Barnscott,
yes.
So you couldn't take the country boy out of him?
I couldn't, and I did not. I admired him for that.
He loved nature.
He did. He did very much. He always can tell you, oh, that full moon is going to bring rain. You know, I don't know, but maybe it's the crescent. When they come, he say, oh, look at the crescent, it's going to bring rain, it's going to be dry weather. He loved nature. I think he always read the McDonald's calendar. So he got all of his ideas from there. He would tell me, do you have any pawpaw seeds? Today is the day to put them in. You know, and the pumpkin seeds, today is the day to put them in. So
he was a man for all seasons.
Oh, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes. He liked to cook.
Loved cooking?
He loved to cook, yes. Mm-hmm. I can remember when we were courting, he cooked a lovely chicken curry. That was not what won me to him.
I thought
although the saying is the way to a man's heart is through his stomach.
So what won you to him?
What won me to him? His persistence. I knew Sim long ago, before we started courting. I knew him living with the Anglican minister, Father Thomas, W.A. Thomas. I'm sure Spencer mentioned
that. Oh, yeah, we heard about that last
night.
Mm-hmm.
I knew him from then. When he lived with Father Thomas, he used to come down with messages to my parents.
Oh, which was not far away.
Away. I knew Sim all along. But the itsy bitsy parts of our being in love, it was the will of God. Because never in my wildest dreams did I think that I would have married to Sim. I mean, I knew him. I knew him as a lawyer. I knew him as a friend of the minister. And I remember I did go for a holiday to New York to visit Monica and Esther. And when I came back down, I worked in the post office then. I saw him crossing on the sidewalk where First Caribbean is now. And I rushed out of the post office across the street to let him know that Esther and Monica sent their regards.
Okay.
And that was where it clicked.
The spark.
Yes, the very first night, the night he invited me to go out to dinner. And I said, I have to go to a choir practice, and I have to go to a choir practice. He said, all right, another night. He called me the other night, and I turned him down again. Mm-hmm. And the third time he called me, I went out to dinner with him at Old Manor Hotel. And when we sat down to dinner, Steve, he put his hands across the table and he asked me to marry him.
The third night.
Mm-hmm. And the first night that we were out together, he put his hand across the table and he asked me to marry him. I said, boy, you're crazy. What am I going to tell my parents? And he said, don't worry, I'll take care of that. Mm-hmm. Just click like that.
Just like that.
That is why I say my marriage to Sim was God's will.
There is a saying that behind every great man, there's a great woman. What did it mean to you to be the first lady of Nevis? Independence 1983, for instance, Grove Park.
It was a joy to me. And I knew from my upbringing that I could have performed. It was a joy to be at his side because I recognized him as a great man, a very intelligent man, and it was a joy to be with him. He respected me as a lady, and he loved me for what I did. Mm-hmm. It was a joy to stand up beside him as his first lady.
What would you say was his greatest moment?
There were quite a few moments.
Sure, free to list them.
His recent greatest moment was to see our son become an attorney. Mm-hmm. It was a great joy to Sim to see Adrian called to the bar. And it was a great joy to Adrian and I to have his father there because he made it. And that was Sim's greatest moment prior to his death, that he saw Adrian in his legal attire.
Like father, like son.
And I know that Adrian is going to perform just like his father because he has the ability and he has the training from Sim. So I know it's going to happen.
What has the last few days been like now that he's gone?
How do I say that, Steve? It was a blessing to me. And I thank God that he was finally out of his pain and suffering. It was a relief to him. It was a relief to me to see him out of that suffering. And that's how I felt. I thank God for that.
And a life well lived.
35 years of being married to Sim was, I had no regrets. 35. Mind you, as all married couples, you have your little tiffs and you have your little tuffs. But the makeup is always the best. Never go to bed at nights and don't say sorry. If you're the one to say sorry, say you're sorry. But you know, Steve, the makeup is always the best. Mm-hmm. And both of us, we always say sorry. If I've done anything to offend you today, Sim, I'm sorry. he would say, you know, we spoke about so-so-so this morning. And he said, you know, you were right. I said, okay, thank you for that, because, you know, he's not going to argue. He's going to tell you as it is, and he's going to say, think about it. And then he would come home and he said, you know, you were right about what we spoke about.
Very human side.
Yes, yes, yes.
Uh-huh. He went very quietly.
Yes, he did. He went very quietly in the presence of his doctor, Dr. Jacob, his son Adrian, and my sister Monica, who was his nurse for 6 weeks.
She's been a great help to you.
She has been. She has been. She has been to me as a sister and as a nurse. I couldn't do without her. I couldn't. And, you know, I thank God that she was there for me through thick and thin. She took care of everything, of all my needs.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
We heard on the radio this morning that the funeral service will be next Tuesday.
Yes.
June the 5th.
Yes.
Tell us more about the plans.
Well, the plans are in the hands of the federal government. He will have an official funeral. We will have all the courtesies as a state funeral. But the plans are going pretty good, and the protocol offices are working along with the family.
Sim, let's call him Sim. In life, never sought after glory. And there are many people who have been saying, even before and now, he should be knighted, things should be named after him. What were his views on adulation, being lauded for what he did for Nevis?
I thought it was very good of them to think of him like that. But my husband was a very quiet, simple person. He did not want any accolades. I did talk to him about that, and he said, "What for what? I don't want any accolades. I thank them, but I don't want it. I don't want it." He said, if I need to put my name on a building, I have a building on Main Street, I would have put my name there. I don't want any accolades. He was a very simple person, and he didn't want any accolades. I just want the people to know that. I just want, you know, he was not a proud person, you know. He said, I don't want it. I don't want any accolades.
Very,
I don't want any accolades.
Selfless.
Very selfless. Very selfless.
Washington Archibald, in his book, The Legacy of Dr. Simeon Daniel, said he wrote the books for two reasons. One, because they were friends for a long time. And two, he didn't feel that his political career ended in the way it should have, in that he had done so much for the country that he thought he was invincible, that he should automatically be reelected. Was he really disappointed in June 1st, 1992, when he lost and lost government?
I don't think so. He was ready at the time to get out of politics.
Why was that? He was doing so well. The Four Seasons had come just 1 year prior to that. Yeah. Nevisions had a payday for the first time. Why did he want to leave?
He was anxious to get back into his law office. And he just did not want to go stay into politics.
That's interesting, because there's one thing about the Caribbean politician. He never knows when to leave office. You're saying Sim was happy to go?
Sim was still a politician, you know. But he just did not want to be in too much active politics. Okay? He just came out of it. We know he had been on the radio shows, and he was still very talkative and still, you know, but he didn't want to stay in. He had had enough. And he said, the people have spoken, and that is it. He wasn't mad or anything. He wasn't mad. He was just cool. He said, the people have spoken. So he was satisfied.
He's the country's senior statesman. Mm-hmm. And you said he had his little abode at Ramsbury. He spent a lot of his last 20 years there.
Yes, yes.
Some people think that he distanced himself from the island, whereas other politicians in their twilight years are the toast of the town. Why did he do that? Why did he spend his days in Ramsbury away from the fray?
I don't think he was away from the fray, you know. because he still have a lot of had a lot of visitors going there, talking politics. It's not that he didn't keep away. Mm-hmm. He didn't keep away. He was glad to talk politics.
My brother Hansel Manners, we interviewed him two nights ago.
Uh-huh.
And he said he had just qualified as an accountant and after a career in teaching. And he went to SIM to try and read up, I think, on company law. And SIM went to his shelf, lent him books, and he read voraciously. Mr. Augustine Merchant, who we interviewed yesterday, said that he went to visit him at Ramsbury, and he said, I heard you have a daughter who's a lawyer and you haven't brought her to see me. And so he went back the day after with his daughter, Curlin.
His daughter, yes.
Why did he have this great love of people and always felt that he had to help, reach out to people, especially young Navisians?
Because of the man he was. First, he was a family man. So he was interested in children. That was Sim all over. He would take his heart out and give it to you. He leaves me undone to help others.
There's so many stories about that.
Yes.
Around Nevis.
Yes. And Nevis, that was Sim.
Smile.
That was Sim all over. He was a very humble, spirited person. Very religious person.
Is that why he determined he wanted to go back to St. Thomas's Anglican, the church
of the Hill? Well, that was his church. That was where he was brought up. That is where he served on the altar. That is where he was in the choir. That is where he was a member of the church vestry. That's his church that he goes to on a Wednesday morning at 7 o'clock. He goes there because of the quietness of that service. He didn't want to go to, not that he didn't love the fellowship, but he just wanted to be quiet. So he would go to a 7 o'clock service and he'd be home by 8 o'clock and that's it for him.
There was a caller to the radio this morning, Mrs. Lorna Howell, who plays organ, I believe, sometimes.
She used to, yes.
At St. Thomas's. Mm-hmm. And she said there was a time that she noticed there were a lot of visitors and they didn't have books, hymn books for the visitors. And she mentioned it to Sim, or Sim asked her about it.
Mm-hmm.
Next thing she knows, she had a organ or piano.
Yes, yes.
Generous man.
Yes, that was the keyboard that he has. And I remember that. That was before I started to play, but I played on the same organ, you know, the little keyboard. Yeah, very generous. I tell you, he left me undone to help others. I mean, I didn't give him wrong. I encouraged him.
He was the people's man.
Exactly. I encouraged him.
Now, when he closed his eyes here last Sunday,
mm-hmm.
May 27, do you think he felt fulfilled?
Yes. Yes.
Why?
I think, as the good book said, he fought a good fight. The battle was done. He battled for his people, and he battled for himself, and that was it. Because many times he said to me, I'm ready to die. It was as though he had finished his course.
Even without his beloved secession?
That too, yes.
He was able to be at peace with that?
I don't know, because he never spoke about it much to me.
Do you think Navisians understood Sim?
Some of them did.
You think a vast majority didn't?
Didn't know. They did not know the man, Sim Daniel.
Is that because he was so quiet that he didn't express himself openly?
I think it's that. They thought they knew the politician, Sim Daniel, but they didn't know the man, Sim Daniel.
There is a difference. You think that in time, maybe with more books, maybe not Washington Archibald, maybe by me, that Navisians will reconcile that? They won't?
No. The man is gone.
Yes, but sometimes we take a different view.
Uh-huh.
Here's your building. If I look at it from this angle, it appears one way. If I go on the other side, it appears another way. Even Robert Bradshaw in St. Kitts was deemed to be a very bad man by Navisians. I think Navisians are now seeing him in a different light.
Yeah.
Don't you think
so? You think that they would see him in a different light 10, 15 years down?
I am certain of that. I think even today,
mm-hmm.
tomorrow, and the days before he's interred, that people will begin to get a better measure of the man.
Well, to tell you the truth, it is a delight to me to see how people are talking about him now. I'm happy about it, that at least before his body is interred, that they are remembering him.
He'll be remembered for a long time.
I hope so. I definitely hope so.
Welcome to my world.
This is one of my favorite spots of my garden. And there are times that Sim would drive his car, come here. He would come out and maybe look at the animals, sit in the chair, if I had other chairs out here which were more comfortable. And then we'd go in and just enjoy home. I'm going to miss him so much, so much.
The key to this world of mine, I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you.